that feeling that you get when you help that person, or you're able to bring somebody down off a mountain and their family's standing there waiting. You feel like, you know what, I made a difference today.
There's a family out there who is having the worst day of their life, and they need support.
That is someone's brother, that's someone's mother, sister, you know, cousin, aunt, uncle, friend. They're hurt, they're lost, they're lonely, they're scared.
Every child is our child when we're out looking for some kid.
When the rescuer finds you, you find life again. You find your life.
Search and Rescue is made possible in part by the Pacific Mountain Network and the contributing members of KUED. Thank you.
So I was 15, and my cousins and I decided to spend the day together and hike up to a waterfall and watch the sunset. And the plan was to hike back down when we were done. And when they were climbing up the face of this rock, one of them lost his footing and fell all the way to the bottom. And when he fell, he left his youngest brother still clinging to the rock face. And so I sat there. And the fear was indescribable. It was paralyzing. I sat there next to his lifeless body for what seemed like forever. And the sun started to go down, and then I saw two faces come up over that ledge that I looked at for a long time. It was search and rescue. And I was so grateful. Little did I know it was volunteers. And that people that we didn't know, they didn't know who we were, and they just volunteered to leave their family at a moment's notice to come help a total stranger. And that's when I decided, when I found out who they were, that's what I wanted to do. Every call to me is personal. I can't see myself doing anything else. I love it. The driving factor for me hasn't changed. The experience that we had, I mean, it's like I lived it yesterday. It's still fresh on my mind, and that continues to push me.
"911, what is the address of your emergency?"
So we're in Polo Canyon, west, upwards and west of Bridalville Falls, and we can't get down. We're stuck. We have no lights.
Initially, what happens, a person will call 911. So then the sheriff says, page out the search and rescue based on what they know of the scenario.
Yeah, this is challenging. We've got a couple of stranded hikers that are quite a ways up the mountain. They're above Bridalville Falls, up through kind of a dangerous chute.
Because that lower part of the chute's kind of dicey. Unless you have a good rope or garden hose dangling there.
I think search and rescue is more in an element of a remote area or a disaster. So it's an environment that normal people can't get to, and you need special skills to get to it or operate in that environment.
Search and rescue in Utah, by statute, is through the sheriff's office. The sheriff is charged with all search and rescue operations in his or her county. The state has set up a way that search and rescue teams can get reimbursed for their actual cost of their search. Now, there are some counties that actually will bill people. It's left up to the county. Ultimately, the idea is we don't want people hesitating or wondering, I am 10 miles from anywhere and I need some help. What's this going to cost me?
We got to raise first up to this level. All right, three of us are on our way.
Well, a lot of people don't understand in the U.S. that when you get lost or when you need rescue, that you're being rescued by volunteers.
These volunteers, You know, they leave their family for nothing. They pay for their own gas, their vehicles, all the equipment they have to buy. And they come, you know, all hours of the night.
CP Team 1's with R85s. They look code 4.
Cold?
Search and rescue volunteers come from all walks of life. They may be doctors, they may be mechanics, they're men, they're women, they're all ages and all classes. And what they bring is a pool of expertise, a pool of problem solvers, a set of boots on the ground that a county sheriff can draw on in order to solve a particularly unique or difficult problem.
It employs so many extra skills and so many extra people, and sometimes there's a lot of ground to cover, and without those volunteers, we couldn't do that. These guys put their heart and soul into those rescues. They do. I mean, they don't know those people. They're a complete stranger most of the time, but they put their lives on the line for them. But they do it because they know they are making a difference.
Don't hug you. I'm gross, guys. I'm gross.
Mm. Welcome back, man.
You're alive. How have you been here?
Yeah, I'm glad I'm safe.
Well, we wanted to, there's an old restaurant at the top, and we wanted to reach it and underestimated how far away it was.
Yeah.
And then we got lost, and it was getting dark, so we decided to call it search and rescue.
Things just happen. They really do. Things happen. And if you're in a remote area, it's a totally different situation. A lot of times they don't go prepared. And next thing you know, they're miles and miles away from anything. They don't have food. They're out of water.
We did talk about it like halfway up, but hey, maybe we should come back tomorrow or just go back and all. But I was like, we're halfway up, so we should just try.
Yeah.
Probably the famous last words.
Yeah.
Okay. 5:30.
Awesome.
A search and rescue member, what we're looking for, we look for potential. We take applications throughout the year, and once a year we do interviews, and we'll interview 30 people, and we'll select out of there around a dozen.
Most of them come in not realizing the time commitment that it takes, and the emotional commitment it takes, and the financial commitment it takes to be a very strong search and rescue member. But those who are not prepared to make those three commitments, they're not successful.
What if we just went like that?
Perfect.
And then...
So the reason I'm doing this is 2 years ago, actually, I was saved by Zion National Park Search and Rescue. We got stuck for 2 days in a slot canyon, and man, those were... There were a long couple nights in the canyon. It made you rethink things in life.
What's happening? Should we put you down for a nap, hon?
Oh. Being a new dad, like it's easy to leave when she's sleeping. But when she's awake, it, you know, it's kind of hard to be like, I gotta go.
Should we do some tummy time?
Yeah. My wife, Caitlin's been very, very supportive, you know, and I think that she was the one that suggested I do search and rescue. But she thinks that I brought it up. Anyway, I don't know. Either way, I'm doing it, and we'll see how it goes.
Can you give me a big smile, honey? I got you binky.
I do want to get to the calls. I want to be on the first team. I want the members to know me and to know that I can do what I'm asked, you know?
The first few months, it's just going to every single call, and it's getting to know the team so that you know if I show up on a call with you, what skills you have. You know my skills, and you can trust me and my strengths and weaknesses.
I was excited then just to be a part of it and kind of look over people's shoulders and just watch.
You live and you just sleep with your radio right here or your pager just waiting for it to go off.
I craved it. You know, it was new gear. It was cool gear. It was fun to play with, and I just wanted to be elbow deep in it.
So in terms of gear, that's kind of my bigger pack.
Hasty pack.
Pulleys. A few different kinds of ropes, crampons, ice axe, ascending systems. I won't pull all this stuff out.
When you say ice axe, do you mean like technical?
So we had two trainings a month as new members. We had a classroom setting where we would go through maybe the GPS units, how they work, or avalanche beacons and how they work, and then we would go out in the field or up in the mountains and actually use it.
I'm picking up someone right next to me.
Today, like what most of our trainings will be like, is just an introduction, kind of an awareness. Basic safety things like we talked about there. You don't come into avalanche terrain without a beacon on, a shovel, and a probe. It's to give them enough exposure to what we do and the environments that we operate in to have them competent enough to come in and support us.
I am a probie on the Utah County Search and Rescue Team, so I'm here to learn. In the real world, I'm a professor of mathematics at Brigham Young University. I've been doing this a month now. I haven't gone on a call yet, so no surprises yet. I want to be part of it, helping people, being there for them on what might be the worst day of their life and time when they're lonely and scared and not really sure if they're going to make it. To be able to help them out is something I would love to be part of.
Here we go.
I'm a registered nurse. Well, I love the outdoors. I mean, everybody's going to say that that's here. So you'd be a fool to join SAR and not love the outdoors. But I like working in a team environment. So for me, the real draw is working with a group of skilled people who are working together for a single purpose.
But try to go systematically, not just randomly poking all over. Start here and then go around.
There's a lot of training that I feel I need. I'm excited for all the mountain technical stuff. I just have a ton to learn, you know?
I'm prior military, and I miss the camaraderie. And there's always the bigger mission. There's always, you're doing something that's bigger than yourself. And that's kind of what this does.
Every step we take, right?
You just keep going. If you can't finish the march in training, you can't get on the mountain to save a life. I'm going from point A to point B. You can't stop me. There's nothing that's gonna get in my way. And if I can't walk it, I'm gonna crawl it. You know? And that's our mentality.
Yay!
We're not normal. Right in the head. We're doing something that normal people just don't do.
Apparently it's the greatest hill on earth though.
Yeah, I've had it up to my waist.
There's a full year of training that we go through, and then we pass the test and all of that, and then we're accepted as a full-fledged member.
Think you're gonna make it?
Absolutely.
Attention fire dispatch.
Yeah, my wife went hiking early this morning up the tent, and she's not back yet.
Okay.
She's an experienced hiker. She should have been back hours ago.
Called at 3:00. She called him to say, get dinner ready. And that's the last thing that anyone's heard. Ping, no ping, phone's dead.
If you're looking for someone, you have to crawl into their head and try to figure out what's going on in their mind and why they're here and what's motivating them. You know, climbers go up, fishermen stay near the river, left-handed people turn left on the trail, right-handed people turn right. That is helpful, but that doesn't solve the problem for you.
We also consider, okay, is it getting dark? What's the temperatures? So those kind of things make a difference in our response, how hasty and what we're going to launch as far as an airplane and things like that.
Well, and you really don't know what your resources will be either. So a helicopter is available for a while and then it's no longer available. Your volunteers come in and out. So you have people in groups coming in and out all the time. So you don't know the nature of the problem and you don't know exactly what you're going to have to solve that problem with. So you really have to get boots on the ground, get in there and start looking. And sometimes that looking is bush by bush.
We have other resources like the horse posse if we need to carry heavy equipment. Or bring people down that are just not able to walk. We have helicopters or airplanes as well.
We get out there and we see those family members, and they're right there in our command centers, and they're worried about what's going on. That adds a lot of stress to us too, but it's also a motivator for us also to go out and do our best.
they're feeling scared. They have fear. They think the worst. They don't know. And so they could be just fine. A lot of times they are fine.
Found her. She's okay.
90% of the time, they show up within hours. But sometimes they don't.
Love you.
We are now receiving about 120 calls for assistance every year, so about 120 missions a year. I can't get to all of them. Nobody gets to all of them.
Let's go ahead and lightly strap her in. Also, let's make a stirrup for this.
We need to work as a team. No one person's going to be able to pull off these kind of technical calls that we have. If you come to us as an EMT or a diver or the best climber ever, it doesn't matter if you can't play nice.
Ooh-wee.
People think we're mad at each other, but deep down we really love each other.
You develop a bond and a friendship with them, but you also develop an understanding of what their capabilities are, what where their strengths are and where their weaknesses are.
You're experiencing traumatic situations together. It bonds you together. You know, we're working side by side, shoulder to shoulder to carry somebody out. And it's our blood, sweat, and tears put together to do it. And it's, I got your back, you got my back motto. And when you go through all of that, you just become a second family.
Usually, when we go, we do our job, it's a little bit exciting, and we love working as a team, and things go really well.
Thank you very much.
But every once in a while, things out of our control, you know, people fall off cliffs or whatever and die, and we hate to see that happen. You have to be careful in how you don't store up those kind of memories and let those fester. And in some cases, you really can't afford to think about it too much.
I think the darkest thing for a search and rescue person is when their best effort doesn't lead to a good outcome. You do everything right, you do your best effort, you've trained for this, and it still didn't work. And when that happens, there's a level of frustration and darkness that's really difficult.
They called us out around midnight. John and his brothers went down in the cave, and he happened to go to the one spot in the whole cave that would really give us any significant trouble. He was stuck really bad in it. I mean, you have to go down narrow passage and up and straight down and over and back at an angle, and he was face down.
We've never seen anything this technical, this tough, to get in and get this person out.
26-year-old John Jones went to BYU and was in his second year of med school.
The rescuers had to squeeze through narrow, twisting passageways.
Jones loved the outdoors and explored caves before, but this
one
was different.
John Jones' feet were sticking out, his head down, his body completely plugging a narrow tunnel 10 to 14 inches wide.
I was the first one to him, and he was still very lucid. Just, Susie, I really want to get out of here. Okay, we're gonna get you out of here. Let's try a couple things. He was pretty thirsty. It was really hard to get in there, even for me, and I had been stuck in Nutty Putty before.
I remember looking down to where he's at, and I could see the tops of his soles of his shoes. He thought that it was just a little squeeze point, that he could squeeze through that and it would open up into a big room, and he could turn around and come back out the way he came in. It didn't. It was just a crack that just went down to nothing.
And he'd had his arm stuffed in there like he was trying to crawl through there, and that's how he got wedged.
Tried a couple different things, you know, cutting his pants, certain knots, they got anchors up.
Tried to wiggle him out and tried to pull him out. None of those were working.
I could see that this was much more dire and that we were in a load of trouble. And I didn't know yet where we were gonna go from that.
Since Tuesday night, rescuers struggled against the unforgiving topography of Nutty Putty Cave.
The cave rescue is a different animal, totally different. An environment you're totally unaware of. Your brain is grappling with the fact that you're several hundred feet underground sometimes, total darkness.
It's musty, it's dry, yet sticky at the same time. You're hot, but yet if you work too hard and you're a little sweaty, then you're a little bit cold. The way that your voice sounds off of the walls as you talk, or you can hear people, and the way light bounces.
You're battling your own internal problems, and then you've got to think about your patient. A lot of times, the experience will go down to the lowest common denominator, and that's survival. It was a really precarious situation. I was able to stand above him, but because of the way it was situated, I had to lean one shoulder up against one wall, have a foot braced on the other wall, and I could only reach down with one hand to talk to him, take his pulse, and help him. He was starting to get really upset.
Anytime you're in a position where you don't have control over when you come and go, it's got to have an effect on a person emotionally.
Time, there is no time in a cave. It doesn't exist.
Cave time is bizarre. Cave time is really, it's not like above ground time. He thought he'd been there for 2 days. So, you know, I explained to him he'd only been there 8 hours, which is not the whole truth, but it's what he needed to hear. And so I talked to him, you know, hey, you've been here 8 hours. It's a walk in the park. It's a day shift, you know. Big deal. And when he started thinking about that way, he calmed down and he relaxed, and he realized that there were people there to help him.
Rescuers bolted a pulley system into the rock for more leverage. That moved Jones a little way.
We were hearing of progress being made, and that John was on his way coming out. We had a helicopter, I believe it was Lifeflight, who was there, and they were talking to the ambulance, and they were making plans, you know, are we gonna go by ground, transport, or air?
I still thought things were going really well. So I was optimistic, overly optimistic. And they stuck me in front of a camera, so it was a big national story.
He's free of the tightest spot where gravity was really working against him, and he didn't have any leverage. There's still some more tight spots in the cave. Actually, I think they've got him past all the hard spots now.
That was my second mistake, because about that time, something went wrong down below. And he'd been there for a long time.
They have a raising system that was helping to hold him in position. One of the devices failed, and Mr. Jones actually ended up falling back into the area where he had been stuck for so long.
We're now ending. We're coming up on 24 hours now. You could see it in their face. It was not going to have a good outcome.
I was ready to go back in the cave and went for the assignment at the command center, and they said, John, I'm not going to put you back in the cave. He says, I got the toughest assignment of anything. I need you to be the liaison with the family. We had one more try. If that one didn't work, we were out of ideas.
We were still ready to go, and wasn't ready to give up yet. There had to be another plan. What was gonna be the next thing? We had air hammers.
We're planning on, okay, we're just gonna be chiseling and putting in bags and passing it down the line. And
these guys that were drilling, they were literally just laying on their back with an air hammer right up above their face with this chisel and drilling and knocking rock down onto them.
Okay, we've got to get them out now.
The pneumatic drills on that hard rock, we could see pretty quick that we weren't gonna have enough time to use those drills to open up that passage.
I was there when the mom talked to, and the son and the wife talked to the son and said their goodbyes, as he was losing consciousness. The wife was trying to contemplate what life was going to be like without him. They had a young child, and she was pregnant with a second one. He was a medical student, so life was changing pretty fast for her, and she was trying to assimilate all that.
At this point, it's getting close to Thursday, you know, Thanksgiving. And that point, they saw that he had passed away just probably an hour or so before Thanksgiving. We just sat there in the cave and, you know, what are you going to tell people on the surface? And you knew the family was there. Yeah, that was not good to come out and have to give a mom that news, you know, or a wife, you know.
Yeah, it's hard to pull out and to say it's not a rescue anymore, it's a recovery. So I didn't sleep much after that.
Today's decisions were the latest in a week of tough calls that have left the family and rescuers emotionally drained. Continuing the recovery effort would put those rescuers in danger.
It will be the final resting place for our son and our brother. It was a heroic effort, and there are some that feel like they have failed our family, and we just want to say that we know that they have done everything in their means possible to save our brother.
Many of the cavers and all the rescuers had some serious psychological side effects to this. It was pretty profound. Some of the cavers have never been back in a cave again. It's left some major scars on our team. You know, we're all alphas. A lot of us are, and you're just going in, you save the people and you rescue them, and we did it.
Immediately I started thinking over what I could have done differently. What if I'd inserted myself and drilled those bolts sooner? What if, you know, I should have let him talk to his wife again? And that went on for weeks, just questioning and second guessing.
Could I have gone further and, you know, helped him push up on his hands or get up anymore? That's the only one where we've ever left someone. Otherwise, we will keep going until we find that person and bring that person home.
We did our absolute best. We all worked our absolute best. We did everything we knew how to do. But fast forward years later, after I've learned more, it's harder now than it was then. Because I've learned some skills and mindset that would have made things different and will make things different in the future. So it's much harder now than it was then.
I think the worst feeling that a search and rescue member can experience is being there and not having anything you can do to help. There's situations where we just feel helpless.
And there's something called critical incident stress management, where there's some techniques, some processes that you can use as a group to do really a group therapy. Those things are not always successful. They're helpful, but they're not always successful. In the end, most search and rescue people have to carry a little bit of a burden, and you carry that baggage with you for years. It's hard, it's heavy baggage. I think that's one of the great things about search and rescue, though, is that there's somebody who's willing to do that. And they're your neighbor, they're your friend, they're your co-worker, they're somebody right next to you on the bus, and they're gonna get off that bus and go train and work out and get ready to solve a problem that you can't even imagine.
Yeah. I'll be planning on a 200 for me, okay? Sir. So you can drop your 75, I'll get a 200 for you.
Well, there's a number of different types of search and rescues that we have to do. We do things in swift water. We do things in the mountains. We do things out in the desert. We do things underground. All of those require different kinds of skills and different kinds of training.
Where's Matt?
I feel lots of stress every time we come to training because they do a good job of making it realistic, and you feel pressure, and I think that's probably how it is on the real calls. Do I know the right knot? Do I know the right technical rigging system? Am I communicating effectively? Am I the annoying new guy, or am I the new guy that people want on their team?
BP's 134 over 82.
But that scree slope training was, that was intense. It was fun. Guys shouting, giving directions, shouting medical information, guys trying to set up a technical rigging system. It was stressful. But I think I learned more there about what not to do. And you're climbing, you're like, oh, I gotta get to that spot. And you start climbing across and you're pushing rocks down where the team is and the victim is, and then they yell at you and you feel like an idiot. I mean, that's how you learn, right?
All right, down slow.
It's just fun, you know? It's like, you know, you're practicing skills that can help somebody, but at the same time, you're just having a blast doing it. Oh, it's kind of a selfish philanthropy. The technical skills have been harder. You know, some of these guys on the team are phenomenal. You know, they know all the knots, they know all the knot names. You know, they're comfortable with the ropes. They just throw them on and, you know, throw them back off again. And they've got things hanging off their belt that I don't even know what the purpose of them are. And so some of that's a little intimidating. At the same time, it's a really fun challenge. You know, it's enjoyable to learn that skill. Attendance has been difficult, you know, just with getting to the call-outs and even to some of the meetings, and that's been an obstacle to deal with. And then we've lost two of our members, our little newbie members, and you hope not to be the next one. You hope that life doesn't get too much in the way.
You're positioned on the right spot relative to the litter.
On the first training that we went out with Bruce, he said half of you will not be on the team at the end of the year, just statistically, not that they cut anybody. People will see that the commitment is significant, that it's, you know, it's not just a hobby, it's a lifestyle.
To all units on the mountain, we're changing to Fire 5. Okay.
I've been having my radio on so that I hear the chatter even before the page comes. The first four or five people are gonna be team one. You gotta fly if you wanna be on the first team. You know, I dropped everything and got in my car and drove up to Stewart Falls, and there was a young mother there who, it was her birthday actually, and she had slipped at the falls and broken her ankle. Search and rescue seems to be all about, you know, being prepared. So it was good. I felt like I did good that day.
We were requested by Washington County Sheriff's Office to do a search for a missing child that was caught in the flash flood that happened up in Colorado City.
Shock and disbelief in southern Utah.
A frantic search for the missing.
12 dead, mostly children, washed away in a flash.
Residents gathered to watch while others tried to put the loss in
perspective. As the search continues for a missing 6-year-old boy, it is...
We started out with probably 8 or 10 guys, which probably would have covered what we're going to do, but if we've got a lot of people, I think we're going to be better off. One little guy is only 6 years old, and he could be hidden pretty well. ID I've got by talking to some of the people that's found the other kids, as they've been high on the high water marks out toward the outside, up in the bushes, is where most of those kids have been found.
I've seen a huge change over the last few years where all the teams are actually talking with each other across county lines. I remember when they used to not be able to do that. That's our county line, you don't cross the county line. But these teams work together. They're more worried about completing the mission and doing those things. And that's, ultimately, that's to help other people.
I had to swim a couple times in deep water. And looked in a lot of places.
The biggest problem is that when the water came through, it looks like a lot of the walls collapsed in. So, you know, it's very difficult to walk out of there convinced that you've exhausted all possibilities that he's in there. We did the best we could, obviously, and if he's in there, he is buried.
Body recovery is when you have a victim that's in a remote area and something's happened to them. They've fallen off a cliff or jumped off a cliff, or there was an accident. Why search and rescue is involved is because it takes some special skills to operate in that environment. It's not an everyday thing for them. You know, you have different reactions from different volunteers.
You never know, life can be going along just smooth and great and grand, and in 1 minute, 1 second, life can change. The best idea was to get a helicopter in, get a couple guys up in the air, start doing some recon, looking around, navigating the area, see if we could see where he's at. And then if all else, we could get up on top of the mountain, talk with the two friends, the RPs that were with him, to kind of get an idea of, all right, what's the best way to get our victim out.
The very apex of the mountain is really a knife's edge, and it's very slippery up there. They have, it's absolute shale. You gotta really watch where your feet are at, and it's very dangerous.
I think it was Matt and Matt were the two friends, and they had made it through and they turned around and had seen their friend falling. I can't imagine. I can't even put myself in their position. I feel terrible. I feel bad for them. Because that's something they're going to live with the rest of their life. They were asking us, like, oh, man, we don't know what, could we have done anything different? They were trying to process what just happened in their minds and the doubts and the questions, and so we made them feel as comfortable as we could and confident in our voices and saying, look, you guys did everything you could. You shouldn't have any regrets with what happened. You know, Greg was doing what he loved to do. You know, we do something that's dangerous. There is an element of danger to it, and we put ourselves in situations that even the most experienced, one slip and it's can be tragic.
It was, can I say disturbing? It was disturbing to see somebody who had, fallen how many feet? 1,600? And tumbling that far, you know, he was not in good shape. And seeing that and experiencing all the senses that you do, you know, not just the sight, but the other senses.
To me, it's very surreal whenever you do body recoveries. And something personally for me on this call, when we were with this, when we got kind of down off the mountain, I found out that he's a volunteer firefighter for Tooele, 40 years old, 2 kids. I work for a fire station, part-time at American Fork. I'm 42 years old. I've got 4 kids, not 2 kids, but a lot of similarities that kind of hit home, and it's like,
It makes me think twice about doing stuff, that's for sure, you know? And not that they were doing anything crazy, but it does make me go, I'm gonna check this knot again, I'm gonna check this again, and there are some things I guess you can't control, but I think it makes me be more safe overall.
I don't wanna say it's tough. It's a hard thing to process.
Yeah, I mean, I read the news articles and I read his Facebook page and stuff like that, and you know, looking up some of those things helped me kind of put a personality to the body I was handling, you know. But it was good to talk, you know. I think it's always good to talk.
I remember just standing up there and I thought, wow, just life changed. All 3 of their lives changed. 1 individual's passed on and 2 friends. life's changed forever. Are you ready at that second to say, yeah, I've told all the ones that I love, thank you. I forgive those that have maybe wronged me. Have I apologized to those that I've wronged? Because you never know when you're gonna get that chance.
The search and rescue mentality is they really want to be the one to be responsible to help. They want to have the skills to solve that problem. They want to work a problem.
Command operation. Go ahead. Taken free from the rock. We're now loading a Minnesota.
I think the ongoing motivation is intrinsic in the job.
Patient is packaged, we're about ready to move. No one will be tied into the stove. We're just gonna use a lot of hands to go hand over hand and get him down here. All right, let's go, everybody.
Copy, downflow.
When we do something difficult and we help someone who really needed it, that's the biggest reward there is.
Everything that we do is for somebody that's kind of got in trouble. Somebody has had an experience that you guarantee when they see their loved ones in the parking lot or at the hospital, there's tears shed. And I think the simplicity of life is brought into one small granular love. And I think search and rescue has helped me with the people we've helped, and you get to see that.
And it's why a lot of search and rescue people keep coming back to this business and are willing to go out in the middle of the night, on weekends, on holidays, away from family, to meet a stranger, to save a stranger, to help a stranger, and to get that feedback. Where we find somebody who needs our help and we give them what they need, and they give us something back too.
Hope is a mindset. You can structure a way for things to get better.
I haven't been here for 3 years since I broke my leg on this hike, and I have always known that I wanted to come back, and I'm hoping that this is a closure.
I told him I would be back no later than 8 or 9 o'clock that night. And I left and got in my car and drove to the trailhead and parked where he said to park and hiked the trail and then got to what I knew was the end of the trail. But the trail appeared to keep going. And I felt so good. So I thought, I'll just follow this trail up a little ways. And I followed it, and all of a sudden it started getting dark. There are a lot of these little scree slopes, and the scree slopes go down to like a 30-foot drop. And I skidded and slid about 2 feet and looked over, shined my flashlight over, and at that point I said to myself, stop, you're gonna die of stupidity. And found a nice flat place, made a big fire. And the next morning, thought to myself, if I can get out of here fast enough and back to where the motel, they're not gonna send anybody out after me. I was really getting frantic because I didn't want to be late. I was embarrassed. So I was trying to go faster and faster and faster. I made the classic hiker's mistake. All big accidents happen in descent. They didn't notice that the ground was sand and I had been walking on rock. I lost my balance, fell sideways. Looked at my foot, which was completely, obviously no longer attached to the rest of my leg, and thought, I have a tib-fib fracture. That was my first thought. And then I said, well, at least they're already looking for me. That was my very next thought.
So Victoria, checks into the hotel. She tells the clerk, this is where I'm going to go, and writes it on the map. She's extremely responsible. If I'm not back by 9:30, call 911, kind of a thing. The desk clerk didn't tell anyone.
So I was expecting that now it had been 12 hours, you know, so someone was going to start coming. They were going to start looking for me. And that was at 7:30 in the morning. I broke my leg 7:30 in the morning on a Tuesday. By 4, 4:30 and nobody had come, I thought I might be out here longer than I think. Maybe I'm not where I think I am.
It didn't have all that grass in it. That grass is new. Or maybe I did. This was the steps. It was that one.
Mm-hmm. I had to get out of that bowl because there was no water and there was nothing there I could burn. And I knew that if I slipped down and my foot hit the ground, that would come right through the skin. I would have a compound fracture and an open wound and I would be dead. So I couldn't fall. I dragged myself. And as I was going, I picked up dry wood so that when I got down to the stream, I had enough dry wood that I could have an ash bed for that night to keep me warm that night also. But that was the last night I had a fire. Thursday night was the night I really kind of fell apart emotionally. But nothing ever changed what my job was. You know, I was just confident that if I did the right thing, I would survive. And then Friday night was the night that I thought, well, maybe I'm not going to survive.
It's a big place. It's an especially big place if you have poor information or instructions on how to try to find somebody. It becomes an awful big place.
You know, you're just looking for that needle in a haystack. So I jumped on a horse and found tracks going down into the canyon, but not coming out. Gray called out a helicopter at that point for an overnight search and see if they could pick it up on infrared.
The helicopter flies over and changes my paradigm, shifts my paradigm. And I thought, I'm saved. It had such a bright light, I assumed it saw me, which apparently it didn't because I was too... It was using heat-seeking stuff, and I was too cold by then. But that really buoyed me up. It's like seeing the finish line. After that, I was really confident. I can get through one more night. I can finish this night. I can get through this because I know they're coming. They know I'm here. They found me.
Lost people, hurt people are usually dead or found within 72 hours. With Victoria, I kind of had a formulated thing that we're going to gather a body. And when I actually saw her wave, it's just like, wow, she's actually moving.
It was really pretty sketchy on what we had of her. And when we flew out, as I recall, we hadn't been flying that long when we saw her land down there on the bank by the creek. And when you see somebody and you just know it's them, I mean, you just get goosebumps all over and you just think, ah, they're here. We're gonna be able to help them. This is gonna be the culmination of our search. And, you know, we're gonna be able to help them, but they are gonna be able to live and have an incredible story to tell their family, their siblings, their posterity.
No, but it's wonderful to see you. You still have the same wonderful smile. That's what I remember. I can see you with that big grin on your face.
There's a bond that exists between the person who's lost and the person who's been doing the rescuing that is really indescribable in that way. And it's the most basic kind of bond that humans have.
When the rescuer finds you, you find life again. You find your life. When you think you're gonna die, that last night when I thought, this is, well, I guess my life is over, and then the helicopter flew over, And then that morning they came barreling down, those three guys came barreling down to me and weren't mad at me. They gave me back my future. What else can you give somebody than to say, now you have a future again?
It's the outdoor readiness interview. I got the pregame butterflies right now, you know, kind of the anxious feeling before you have a big game.
Whoa. Hey.
I'm excited just to get the first call over with, you know? And I'll be excited when the sun comes up tomorrow.
Here we go.
Mount Monogus Park.
You know, I still have the adrenaline right now. I'm actually a lot more calm than I thought I'd be. Leading up to this, the last like 3 hours have been miserable. Just because knowing a call's coming, I've never experienced that before.
Just keep playing there. Hey,
just
I don't
keep
know.
What happened to you? What happened?
Calm down.
Rob, do you have any hours?
So far, two calls, three different CPR scenarios, one probably an open fracture. I think it's pretty fun so far. I want to make sure we work as a team. Let's head out there.
100 yards up, there's something reflecting.
You're all right?
Okay. Yep. One, two, three.
That was really good, and you guys were calm and working together as a team.
Okay, purify me some water. I'm thirsty.
So I use the ETC to ascend.
I'm ready for it to be over and maybe not be considered a, you know, support member.
He's done great.
And be one of the legit guys.
We're gonna face challenging rescues. And I think we can look back on these type of experiences and these days of going through the ORI for hours and hours out there. It's like, yeah, I can do this. I got it.
I, and state your name.
I, Brian Rivers.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will support and obey.
That I will support and obey.
And defend the Constitution of the United States.
And defend the Constitution of the United States.
With fidelity.
I think we all save each other in different ways. We save each other sometimes emotionally. The physical save is just so much more intense. But we all save each other.
We're trying to find ourselves as we search for others. We're trying to rescue ourselves as we try to rescue others. And we realize that it could be us there. That every one of us has been lost before and every one of us has needed rescue before. And so it's not a one-way exchange. It's them. It's their son, it's their daughter, it's their mother, it's their father that they're going to look for.
The point is just to see how much better you can make the world. And what can you do to be part of the solution? That's part of life, is not sitting as a bystander, not watching life. You know, I believe it's not what life does to you, it's what you do to life.
I don't feel bad at all about volunteers getting asked to do tough jobs. That's why I'm on the team. I like the difficult ones. I like the challenge, and I like making it turn out right. So that's where I want to be, somewhere where it matters.
There's two hikers out, a couple dogs, one of the dogs was injured. All we knew is the words that they used is that they were dragging something. We assumed it was the dog. We just hiked and the horse got there first. And we just talked to the husband and wife. They just said it was a long, long, cold night. Their dog was injured and they couldn't make it back, so they spent the night on the mountain. And I think they were happy to see some willing, eager faces to help them out, you know. I think I'm realizing that a lot of this is just assisting people when they need assistance.
Search and Rescue is made possible in part by the Pacific Mountain Network and the contributing members of KUED. Thank you.